We're in the university, so I'm compelled to start with Aristoteles. He said that to convince a human being, you need a logos, eros, and pathos. And the pathos piece of it is obviously the one that is most powerful. That is addressing the human emotion. And from the times of Aristoteles, that has been used for communicating with audiences. It has been used for influencing audiences. So we, as a center, asked ourselves a question: how does that work? Of course, we've not been the first ones to ask that question, and many others have done that before us. But for us, it was interesting how it plays out in the modern environment. And of course, there are a whole spectrum of human emotions. Which one do we start? And of course, we've always been very serious about our studies. We thought for a difference, we'll take it something, look at something not that much serious, which is humor. Of course, once you study it more, it becomes more and more serious. Humor is the most intimate ways how you relate to a human being. Because humor disarms. Human makes you think in the terms of community. Humor might be your last resolve in a time when everything really goes bad. That is your last element of psychological defense. So we have been very lucky to have a group of such a good scientists to look at different angles, but most importantly to understand how in a modern environment, in a new circumstances, how humor works. How can you analyze humor and its impact on the audiences? And that is, I think, to me, although the latest parts of a study are the ones that attract most of the attention, I think the most value is the methodology that is going to be presented today. Of course, the method is never good when you without the actual cases or place where you can apply the measurements and understanding of it. So today we will hear a number of case studies, both from Russia and Ukraine. And I think that is important to see that it is still an ongoing method. How do you address the audience? And for us, it is important to see how subtle sometimes this impact is. I noted with a very big interest, and I would even say I've been flattered a bit, by the way of reaction we have created in Russia to our study. Unfortunately, I kind of reckon most of the people that comment on the study have never gone beyond the actual title of a study. So I would recommend if they see us to actually do a read of what is in the study. But to me, it basically reminded one of the jokes from the Soviet time. And I remember that time. And the joke was about who has more freedom of speech. Is it USSR or is it US? And the answer is, it's equal. Because you both can stand in front of a White House and in Kremlin and criticize the US president all you want. And if you read the study, I remember that joke reading that study. So with that, I think it's now over to Thomas. Thank you.
So now our program is like that. We'll hear first presentation of the study methodology by Professor Jeanette Zolina. Then we will hear presentation of two case studies out of three. And we'll have conclusions part, again by Professor Jeanette Zolina. And questions and discussion session led by me. Yes, I forgot to say, I was responsible for that study, but my job was so easy. Because, you know, they did everything and I just didn't sleep some nights, that's it. Thank you very much. So now I would invite Professor Jeanetta Ozorina to present the methodology of the study.
Thank you very much, Thomas. Distinguished guest, it's my pleasure to introduce with some of findings of our research on how to build analytical framework for analyzing humor in different situations. First of all, I would like to thank Janis Sarts, who was the one who should be blamed for everything, of course with a certain sense of humor, because when we had a chat on what could be the subject of the research on humor, to be more precise, what would be focus. So then Janis was the one who said, so we don't need another collection of case studies, we need something what we can use in different situations and which could be applied in different NATO member states if they wish to work with humor. So therefore it was Janis' idea that we should look beyond case studies and we should search more for theoretical framework. So how to analyze humor, how to deal with humor. So then I also would like to thank Thomas. So of course, despite those two nights, you were very, 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 how to say, patient and very good supervisor of the whole team, because the team was divided in several groups. It's not like we worked in unison, but so Thomas was the one who kept us on the right track, who monitored all timelines. So thank you very much, Thomas. So it's a lot of work was done also by you. Okay. So Thomas already introduced our team, so I will skip this slide because we are a little bit, as always, out of time. And I will go directly to the aim of the study. So this aim was manifold. So first of all, what we wanted to do, we wanted to approach humor from interdisciplinary perspective. When I was drafting the theoretical part for our team, I discovered that there are a lot of studies done on humor, for instance, in semiotics, in cognitive sciences, in political communication. But usually those different approaches always never met each other. So therefore it was very important to find the ways how to combine this beauty of research done already in different fields. Another one was to identify what kind of role humor can play in strategic communication. And I would like to emphasize the study is not about strategic communication. The study is about finding those components of diverse phenomenon of humor which can be applied in strategic communications. And the third aim of our study was, in the end, after those numerous approaches and contemplations, at least to try to elaborate a framework for analysis. And I would like also to remind, before bringing you into this framework, that these were only six people working for 6 months, so do not expect this framework will be universal, comprehensive, the only one. This is probably one of the first attempts to create something and to start discussion from the starting point which is presented in the study. But in the end, we found out that this framework of analysis, it can be used for different purposes. On the one hand, it can be used to analyze and to understand the humor, but on the other hand, it also can assist in constructing humorous messages if somebody wants to do that. Okay, so this is the methodology how we started our research. We first of all drafted a very tentative framework for analysis consisting of five components. I will come to that a little bit later. And on the basis of this drafted some kind of a network or a scheme, we asked our case study scholars to follow the scheme and to do analysis of the cases which they selected. And I think that selection of cases was also very well based, because one which will be presented by Sigita Struberga, it is looking at a series of late night shows. The second one was on KVN, which is again smaller, narrower perspective, looking only at one show, and also looking only at one team which is performing in the show. So therefore, it's some kind of micro case. And there was also a case, the third one, presented by Maxim Kiyak, who is also here, and it's really good that we also have Ukrainian perspective. And here, Maxim looked mostly as humor is working as counter-reaction to different tools of propaganda present in Ukrainian domestic policy. Then, on the basis of those case studies, the team who worked with theoretical framework very carefully went through analysis what was performed by three scholars, and then we reconsidered our initial theoretical framework, complemented it, and in the end, then we draw also our conclusions and recommendations. So, what was the essence, what was the starting point? We started with a definition, and of course, again, numerous definitions. But we decided to stick to George Villain's definition because it's most comprehensive. And it's very much reflected, actually, on the topic what Yannis Sats mentioned on Aristotle, those three components which are essential for human being. It's intellectual component, emotional, and also psychological number. So here is more or less a schematic way how you could look at humor, comprising together those different aspects. The point is that if you look at humor, it can also contain those individual aspects. It could be only about laughter. It can be only about gaiety or levity. But very rarely it's only about intellectual, only about wit. So usually it's a combination. And of course, the strongest influence is at the moment when all those components are, let's say, complementing each other and when they are interacting and creating impact on individuals. So again, trying to identify those components which would be essential for our framework, but also for case studies to be presented later on by three scholars, we identified five the most important elements of humor. These are not, let's say, the only ones. The list could be a very long one. But what we did a very schematic way of exercise. We picked out from different disciplines what they write about humor. And then we tried to find where those interests come together. So what is interesting for all those disciplines? What those disciplines consider as the most relevant? So therefore, in the end, we arrived at five the most important elements of humor. One is a shared knowledge. Very often in literature, it's also called background knowledge or shared ground. Then target audience, the one who is addressed and also who perceives humor. The third one is perception of humor in different audiences and groups, functions of humor, and communication of humor. And I will very quickly lead you through those five components. When it comes to shared knowledge, then what we again picked from the literature is that shared knowledge is a must. It's not something what can be ignored at different periods of dealing with humor. Humor starts with shared knowledge, and to some extent, humor ends with a shared knowledge. If a certain group of people do not have the same interpretation, the same understanding of the topic which is discussed, then unfortunately, humor will not reach its target audience. So, therefore, in the end, we identified the most important, again, those factors which are relevant when somebody is analyzing shared knowledge. And here you can see, again, one of visualization of the study. So, shared knowledge can be culture-dependent and culture-universal. And what we discovered that it's very difficult to work with culture-dependent audiences because their domain of humor is relatively narrow. It's very strong, but it's very narrow. Culture universal humor, the domain is much wider, but unfortunately then it's much difficult to identify those messages, those themes, which could relatively easier address the audience. So, and when it comes to culture-dependent and inside information, then these are those components which are of relevance if somebody wants to study humor, what our case study scholars did. The next one is target audience. And you will find in the booklet which is available that we go through different target audiences. And for each target audience, we try to identify what is humor-sensitive content for this particular audience. So you cannot perceive the same message equally in all audiences. It has a specific sense, specific meaning, which of course has impact on perception of it. But what was probably the most important important part of our study, it was analysis of perception of humor. And on the one hand, perception of humor, it's very much the topic for psychology, but we tried again to look at it from different perspectives. And what we decided to do, not to focus so much on how individuals perceive humor, but how groups are perceiving humor. And therefore, for perception, two variables are of a particular importance, and it is experience and context. And for instance, along the study, we were discussing this issue that on the one hand here is shared knowledge, what we know about something, but then there is something what we have experienced, and it's not exactly the same. So therefore, it's very important to know what is experience of the audience, and also context. And those two components are united by identity. And it led us to an approach which we selected, that we focused on social groups, how groups are perceiving humor. And therefore, there could be different types of models of perception. It can be positive identity, when humor is told within one particular group, and the model and perception model of a winner is formed by humor. And it can be also negative social identity, where humor is used to defend the system, to defend the way of life, what one or another group is sticking to. And another interesting aspect which was of relevance to our study was that via those group identities, there is a clear division between in-group and out-group perception. So very often with the humor, it's possible to include one or another personality in the group of winners, and with the humor, another group of people to push into direction of negative social identity, the outer group. And by the way, not to be too theoretical, just one example, if we look how Russian late night shows and different show programs portrayed Donald Trump before the relations weakened. So Trump was a very nice man, a little bit lost in the world of politics, who needed support, who needed sympathy. And Russian humor shows supported Trump's personality with assistance of humor. While if you look at American late night shows, then Trump was portrayed completely different. So Alan Baldwin tried his best to portray him as a very strange and lost in a different manner. So this is a good example of in-group and out-group relations in perception of humor. So then there is a long list of functions. So in the end, we counted 21. We tried to narrow it down, but for strategic communication and for purposes of working with emotions, several of them are of particular importance. I don't want to go through all of them, otherwise it will take all my time. But like, for instance, function number 4, belongingness and social balance, or function 6, functions of expression or oppressing political freedom. And those functions also indicate that actually it would be wrong to perceive all forms of humor as only influencing individuals or groups' emotions. So humor is just for laugh. But if there is such an interest or there is such intention, then of course it can be used. And those functions could assist in identifying when humor is just for fun and when humor is used for different communication purposes. So then another part of the study is devoted to communication of humor. This is a very wide realm. And of course, scholars from communication field will say it's not enough, there should be much more attention to pay to one or another aspect. Indeed, and they will be absolutely right. But what we wanted to do, we wanted to identify those media settings which could be used as a channels for passing message which is constructed before. And in the end, so here you can see the result of our search for analytical framework. So we started only with those 5 pillars or 5 elements of humor. And in the end, actually, we arrived at a little bit more complex scheme, which should, again, to be reanalyzed and sought through from the beginning, adding new information. So if somebody wants to use humor as a strategic communications tool, it should start with definition what is the goal of this exercise and what is the core message. Then this core message has to be adapted to target audience perception, functions or roles, communication in terms of contact and channels. But if at the very beginning shared knowledge was one of 5 components, now in this drawing you see that this is a fundamental of perceiving, analyzing and applying humor. So shared knowledge here is a must. And then there, of course, is the end result of this exercise, whether a goal is achieved and whether message has been perceived as was the initial idea, but it requires another type of a study, another methodology. And of course, it will be up to scholars and up to those who are interested in this topic whether the study could be continued or not. So here I will stop and I will then give floor to other colleagues.
So now we are going to the second presentation, and it will be presentation of the case study, late night shows on Pervy Kanal and the discreditation of Western political leaders by Ms. Sigita Struberga from University of Latvia.
So, Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. I will try to be short as possible to give some general lines, because as you can guess, I could talk about this for hours if it would be possible. As it was said already, I was working on a case study about discrediting Western leaders within the discourses of late night shows in Pervy Kanal. And I used the framework of analysis offered by research team you heard already. But let me start with a small video.
Yeah, at least you can read.
Yeah.
just a second. No, it doesn't.
So I'm sorry, I thought it would be loud.
Okay.
Oh, it's better.
Oh no.
Sorry.
Can I do something with maybe we can do with microphone or not?
The third attempt will be successful. And there is no Russian plot behind, no. Don't worry. Everything is okay.
G8 превратился в G7? Молодец. Я смотрю, ты разбираешься в политике.
Да.
Молодец. Я в этом месте не издевался, а посочувствовал мировому сообществу. Европейский житель. Выше нос держи. В нынешней семерке нет нормальной G. Невеселый саммит, некому зажечь. Меркель не услышит здесь родную речь. Зря стирал японец ночи кимоно. С кем Алант обсудит женщины вино? Не услышит Кэмерон свежий анекдот. Загрустил Обама. Кто оплатит счет? Лишь одна Канада здесь довольна всем. Пригласили? Ладно, посижу, поем. Ситуация напряженная.
So, but now let's return to the case study. If it was, it was built up from analysis of four late night shows on Pervy Kanal during 8-year period, and I will return to Pervy Kanal later, but now I would like to underline that I did concentrate specifically on jokes about Western leaders. Other jokes I didn't analyze in these late night shows. Also, I would like to underline that I combined my research results with the analysis of researches of media specialists in Russia itself, especially for the first steps of analytical framework. And when we go to context and background, so at first I would like to underline that TV in Russia has become one of the most important links in a chain of administration of the state. It holistically shapes the content of human capital. It has capacity to influence the construction and imposing values, attitudes, ideals, and desired models of society and state structure. Furthermore, TV content is used as a tool to break down the critical thinking of viewers. Also, it should be noted that the state itself plays a triple role for TV. It owns its infrastructure, directly or indirectly. It owns some television channels, and it is a regulatory authority. On another hand, self-censorship and other forms of pressure on TV workers exist, including those which make TV to work as a propaganda tool. And third, the entertainment helps to blur the borders between fact and fiction, to present the information in such a forms which change its content, thereby indicating towards manipulation of the content, as well as to make even critical viewers' attention dissipate. When it comes to the format of humorous shows, it should be noted that the entertainment shows in Russia often are based on the Western models and programs. What distinguishes them and are specific common features of it. As you can see, the similarities, yeah? And now about shared knowledge. I'll mention just some of the features I underlined in a case study. First, one can talk about extensive use of pronouns such as we all, we the nation, we the state. And this closely correlates also with the attempt to develop positive self-representation, where the opposites, us versus them, are actively used. We who represent conservative values versus them, and the outside world is seen as a hostile, not to be trusted. Second, conservation of the former Soviet consciousness of the audience, as well as the maintenance of shared memories and shared rituals that supposedly combine Soviet and contemporary elements. And the third, special place is given to understanding of mysterious Russian soul and Russian high culture, which comes together with emphasizing common historical memory. These and other similar discursive peculiarities enable these programs to transform the time and space axis into a very peculiar hybrid form, on the one hand allowing to move back into the past, but on the other hand to expand it spatially in a space. So, the strategic audience, as Levada Center has concluded, Russian TV and the three state channels in particular today have an almost unbreakable monopoly in setting the country's socio-political agenda and working in a way to toe the Kremlin line. And the entertainment and serials in here take almost half of the broadcasting time. To talk about the audience of these late-night shows I analyzed, one should be underlined that it is important to have a wider view on it. And first, this audience consists of two levels. One is principal audience, and the second is peripeteal audience, and it is about the territorial belonging. But also it is possible to distinguish those who watch TV and those who use TV content via other media. And there are several features uniting so diverse audiences as they are. I'll mention two, the most important in my opinion. First, they use tropes, or in other words, uniting so diverse audiences as they are. I'll mention two, or the most important here. They use tropes, what means that they use words, figurative languages, including allegory, irony, metaphor, etc., which are easily picked up by different ethnic, social, or other socially diverse groups. And these groups support viewer in forming its own identity. And nostalgia phenomenon, it includes Soviet past and memories of it, and it is the most widely shared denominator, actually. And for statement to appear humorous or ridiculous to certain audience, it must meet several preconditions. I'll mention some of them here also. The most significant is the language, of course. Shared knowledge and historical, social, and political memory as a part of it, and knowledge of peculiarities of Russian social structure and verbal art they present. For example, expression, if he beats, he loves you, So in Russian, если бьет, то любит. And also the force would be reduced selectivity, reproduction of sharp, ethnically based racial stereotypes, emphasizing the supremacy of the Russian titular nation. It is also about gender stereotypes, as well as extremely hostile discourse towards others, like sexual minorities. So, and now about the Western leaders. In general, jokes about Western leaders are built in such a way to obtain the specific image of the leader, which highlights deviations from the image of ideal type of leader, mostly in exaggerated manner. And the content analysis demonstrated that jokes most often were made about following leaders Barack Obama, Hillary Clinton, François Hollande, Nicolas Sarkozy, Silvio Berlusconi, George Bush, Angela Merkel, and lately Donald Trump as well. If we compare the jokes about the Western leaders, it should be noted that the jokes mainly focus on US leadership and its activities, and the specific symbolic codes are mainly in relation to the following. This person has low intelligence. This person is double dealer. He has a problems in his private life. And here also various simplified stereotypes are used. I'll take here two examples on US leadership. One is Barack Obama, another Hillary Clinton. During the first election campaign, as well as during initial period following the election, jokes about Barack Obama were relatively natural. The situation changed after disagreements between Russia and US over US plans to place anti-missile defense systems in Europe, and escalation of these and other disagreements between parties later. The jokes demonstrated much more aggressive attitude towards President of US. The correlation between the dynamics of relations between Russia and US and the sharpness of jokes was quite visible. And here is one of the examples. I hope it will work well. No? I'll try to hear.
Святой отец, я грешен. Я, в общем, это убивал. Я Бен Ладена убил. И Каддафи убил. Барк, ты что? У нас официальная встреча. Вокруг полно журналистов. Да ничего, они в курсе. А еще вы знаете, что я еще завидую? Я Джей-Зи завидую и 50 Центу. Еще я жене один раз изменял.
So, now Hillary Clinton, and I would like to offer to have a closer look on jokes about her. The image that has been created by the shows is closely linked to the specific traditional roles of women. Moreover, she has been portrayed mainly as an unattractive woman looking for revenge on her husband. In contrast, Clinton's political activities were rarely discussed, but those that appeared were mainly related to U.S. military actions in Middle East. In this regard, she was mocked as if she could be characterized by her duplicity, indifference, and cruelty, as well as the lies told during public appearances. And here also will be one example.
Хиллари Клинтон официально стала кандидатом в президенты США от Демократической партии. Она стала первой женщиной в истории, которая официально получила билет на пост президента США от Демократической партии. Это первый случай. Первый случай. И у нее мотивация понятна, она хочет попасть в овальный кабинет и отомстить мужу.
По поводу Билла Клинтона, он же уникальный человек. Он был и президентом США, а теперь может стать и первой леди.
Нестандартный подход к выбору президента. Смотрите, в Америке темнокожий президент уже был. возможно, скоро будет либо первый президент женщина, либо первый президент сумасшедший. Что дальше? Дальше будет, вполне возможно, первая темнокожая женщина президент США. И мы понимаем, что несколько сроков и будет первый русский президент США.
And here I also would like to underline that in a period I analyzed it, the President Trump didn't win yet. But now I still keep watching this, and the jokes mainly now are made about that the actually U.S. has become as a district of Russia, and President Trump is like. Like one of the head of the districts of Russia. So now about Angela Merkel. Here the basic set of the code transmitted to the viewer is related to Angela Merkel compliance, or rather non-compliance, to the aesthetic standards by gender stereotypes, while her role as one of the leading politicians in the European Union is almost ignored. As a result, the image of her is portrayed in a way that emphasizes the fact that she is a woman rather than a political leader of the major state. So if we summarize about all these cases, the conclusions over the discourse of jokes about Western leaders, there are several features we can underline. I'll mention some of them. First, the world portrayed is based on legacy of Soviet period, characterized by bipolar perception of the world. The second, existing or imaginary personal qualities of Western political leaders becomes a basic source of ridicule, while much lesser emphasis is placed on their professional actions. And the leadership potential of these highest-ranked politicians as such is questioned. We could move now to the functions of humor. Here also I will mention just some. As you saw in the presentation of Jeanette Ozolina, here is a wide range of functions of humor can perform. And my case study also demonstrated several of them. Here are just some, and I would like to mention dissertation and distraction from reality, stress reduction. Second, support and justification of agenda setting and foreign activities carried out by the government. Third, image construction and educational function. And fourth, legitimation of superiority of the leader in different forms of joking. And here I really would like you to see this video so you can compare how they joke about Western leaders and now about Putin.
Владимир Владимирович, спасибо, что перед началом сезона позвали с нами потренироваться, то у нас на канале один Махачин, Малах Махачин, Олег Ильич. Хорошее упражнение. Владимир Владимирович, вам сделайте, пожалуйста, полегче. Спасибо. Нет, давайте лучше со штангой попробуем. Тяжело сейчас, ага. Спасибо. О, другое дело. Владимир Ильич, вот у меня первый вопрос. Ну вот, после сегодняшнего дня, можно я всем договорить, что с вами мы в одной секции?
So, and in conclusion, I would like to say that the results of case study demonstrate the ways and the means how the industry of entertainment can be subordinated to the needs of the regime, and here, under the mask of innocence, it is possible to feature the most important narratives in creative and soft forms that are attractive and appeal to wide audiences, including apolitical ones and those opposed to the regime, actually. In specific case, the way Western leaders are portrayed in the comedy content of entertainment programs points to disinformation campaign, and its sharpness depends on the dynamics of relations between Russia and the West. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that presentation. So, as you see, from the very beginning, we are going forward, and it's more fun and fun. So now I would like to invite Maxim Kiyak to present this case study on use of humor for solidarity, denigration, and stress relief in the Ukrainian media during the Russian aggression in 2014 and 2016. So, Maxim. The floor is yours.
Thanks. Sveicināti. Hello, everyone. It's a pleasure to be here. Your Excellencies, dear participants, I would like to speak about Ukrainian case and how his humor is being used as a tool for solidarity. And also, I will go further to some examples, and I would like to end up with some conclusions and with future perspectives. But before I start, I think it looks like I have to speak instead of researcher who wanted to say about Kaven case, and considering that fact that which reaction it has caused in Russian media, this case, I think that now speaking instead of that researcher is the same thing as speaking as Zadornov instead of Kaven speaking. So, but still, I will try to do my best. So, and also, as we are speaking about humor, I will start with the words by which some jokes and anecdotes are starting. I have two news, which is bad news and good news. The bad news is that there is no systemic approach and no strategic approach of using humor in Ukraine. But the good news is that there are lots of examples. And still, I try to pick, you know, to find these puzzles and to have this like a general picture of using humor in Ukraine. And what I also found interesting, what I also found useful in this case, is that I used not only the open sources, open data, but I also used I also had like more than 10 meetings with people who are engaged in information policy, engaged in, well, somehow using humor in Ukraine. That's a policymakers, media, people from media, journalists, experts, and politicians as well. So that's why I found this case interesting. But I still try to fit like all the 6 months findings in 15 minutes or maybe less. So as I said, that we have lots of examples. And though I concentrated on 2014-2016 period, but still, just to show you how many examples we have, I just wanted to illustrate the last example, the recent examples of using humor in Ukraine. So just 1 month ago, there was Russia 24 news show, and the journalist said, so the journalist accused the advisor of Minister of Interior of Ukraine that he has organized the murder of the Givi, of the separatist Givi. But he said that that was organized by two people, which are Zoran and Shkiryak. But the thing is that is the one person. That is Zoran Shkiryak. So that's how social media and online media have reacted on it. So you can see Zoran and Shkiryak are like Chip and Dale, or Zoran and Shkiryak is Leon Keeler, and a little girl. And also, what I also found interesting is Zoran Škiriak is being illustrated as Tyler Durden and then the other guy, who actually are the same person, who was who had a split mind. By the way, for those maybe who haven't seen this movie, Fight Club, I'm very sorry for telling you the truth about this movie. So, and the other, just the most recent example is refers to the Hague International Court case of Ukraine against Russia. So the presenter of Russia said that the separatists have used weapons from the coal mines. So somehow they took the tanks and grass from the coal mines and were using it against Ukrainian forces. And that's how social media reacted. Sorry. I guess it's... Oh. Sorry. Oh yeah, here it is. So on the left side, you can see how basically the weapons are being taken. So this is in the middle where the coal is being brought. And just even deeper, we can find some Soviet tanks or whatever. Or on the right side, we can see the separatists are being portrayed as dwarfs, from the Tolkien mythology. By the way, Tolkien mythology will be used very widely during the 2014-2016 period, and I will focus on it a bit later. So that all means that we have like a dynamic situation. Like almost every day we have some information attacks from Russian media, and that's why it was also a bit of complicated to focus on dynamic of this of use of humor in Ukraine. But I still tried to. So what's unique in Ukrainian case to my mind? So the thing is, as I said, that Ukrainian counter-propaganda use of humor were a result of independent and spontaneous initiatives, and less a systemic approach. So there was the absence of real and practical experience in counter-propaganda and restricted financial capacities. That's also very very good point, very important point. And also civil and military volunteers in Ukraine, especially during 2014, have replaced or official authorities in Ukraine countering Russian information attacks. And also what is very important for me, that there was a horizontal organized Ukrainian post-Maidan civil society against Kremlin's vertically constructed propaganda machine. That also refers to uniqueness of this case. Now I would like to focus on the sources which I have analyzed. There were plenty of resources. I will stop only on a few of them, which are TV shows. You can see the Quartal 95, ICTV channel, Channel 24, Channel Espresso, also newspapers and magazines, the Hunta Zeitung. I will focus on it a bit later. Also very important, this magazine, the Zeitung, is being published again by the volunteers. So it's for free for soldiers mainly. Also Narodna Armia, Satiric Checkpoint. I have monitored, I have read almost all of them, which was kind of difficult. Radio, Army FM, which is the new one, it's mainly also for the soldiers. The programs of Army FM are Rota Pidyom, Okupatsiya, Minbrest, online media, you can also see the YouTube channels. Also political caricature of Grigory Klyuchkin and Pekelny Bulba. Now, it was kind of difficult to examine shared knowledge, but thanks to Zanetta, I still manage it. I will. So, of course, Ukraine is a bit of a split or fragmented by some characteristics like language, like religion, like culture, and so on. But still, what is also interesting to know that. So if we, for example, take linguistic peculiarities, it's interesting, I was also even impressed that the latest results saying that 60% of Ukrainian citizens consider Ukrainian language their native language, and Russian language consider as native 15%, about 15%. And also Ukrainian and Russian, both, so bilinguals, are speaking 22%, and other languages about 2%. 90% of Ukrainian-speaking citizens are in favor of independence, but at the same time, fewer than 50% of Russian-speaking citizens are in favor of independence in Ukraine. What I also found interesting that the perception of some historical moments, for example, the vast majority of citizens of Eastern Ukraine perceive a victory in World War II as the main event in the history, and only about 25% of citizens of Western Ukraine perceive the same event as the most important. Still, the most important event they perceive as regaining of independence of Ukraine. So, why I'm trying to provide you with also those examples, those data, it's because unfortunately this split, this fragmentation, of course, was caused by some historical events, has some historical roots. Ukraine was under influence of different countries, different cultures, and this split was also used by during Soviet regime, and of course it was used by Russian propaganda information attacks in 2014, 2016. But of course, humor was still used as a tool of this solidarity to counter such policy of division. I tried to focus on two target groups. The in-group is majority of Ukrainians, so there is, and the out-group is mostly Eastern Ukraine, but of course this is a partial distinction. Russian propaganda can also be accepted by a significant proportion of the in-group. So now let me just go to the specific examples and specific strategies which have been used. So the first strategy is reduction to absurdity. So it's when one characteristic is being taken from the whole message and it is being hyperbolized or diminished. And this process, this strategy is changing absolutely, totally the whole message of the alien propaganda. For example, if we take this video, this is one of the first examples of using this strategy. This video was taken by soldiers of Azov in 2014, and if you remember, during this period, so Ukrainian forces were accused about that there are some American or British or German soldiers fighting for Ukraine, which wasn't true because, I will tell you why, because army was so poor at that time that they had no uniform, that's why they had to buy uniforms in military shops. Well, of course, with those flags. So that's why they, on this video, they are taking this one a specific characteristic about international soldiers and saying, and they are behaving like German and American soldier. On the right side is Thomas Miller. He calls himself Thomas Miller. On the left side is Ashton Kutcher. And they're saying words like Barack Obama, Coca-Cola is the best. And also there is American flag just behind them. So this video didn't go very viral, but still it was one of the first examples of using this strategy in Ukraine. And also there is another good example. If you maybe remember, that was like more than a year ago, the former Prime Minister of Ukraine, Arseniy Yatsenyuk, was accused for fighting in Chechnya for Chechens, like many years ago, which is also very strange. But after that, the social media of Ukraine have portrayed Yatsenyuk as a Muslim soldier, Muslim warrior with a beard, with glasses. So the true Muslim warrior. And another. That's the newspaper I told you about, Reduction to Absurdity. They also try to use this Russian propaganda stereotype that which is using like World War II messages, and they just simply ridiculed it, mocked it with by using, for example, such like Ukrainian German mixed language, which doesn't actually exist. So there, you see, you can see on the right side, like Unsere Bravo Gruppen, and so on. I will not read it all. Yes. So it's just absolutely reduction to absurdity. And of course, this had also influenced Ukrainian soldiers. This has made them more laugh. A parody. I'll just pick one example, which was used by the Quartal 95. It is so they used a parody, you know, the famous Soviet TV series about 17 мгновений весны, 17 moments of the spring, and you can see just there that the Kyiv is the center for fascist junta, and also they are using all the stereotypes about Ukrainians, that they are drinking, they are. They are Nazis, you can see on the left side. And of course, on the right side, the Stirlitz is a very good guy who is liking his, who loves his, who admires his leader. Combination of humor and music is also very good, like, and very viral, I would say. This is one of the examples. This is Orest Lutey. He's basically a singer. He also is a novelist, and that's not his this is not his real name, but that is his scene name, and he uses just simple Soviet or Russian, no, basically Soviet songs, and uses this with Ukrainian patriotic anti-Kremlin anti-chauvinistic lyrics. And this his videos are really going very viral. But what is also important that his songs, his videos have also influenced on appearing another such kind of videos. For example, Mirko Sablich band and Lutiki art formation Lutiki also used this method. But what's very interesting, they tried to take mainly Russian or Soviet cartoons, movies, concerts, and they made it in. They just mix it with some pictures, some memes, and but mainly they are doing it in Russian language. So they are using like Soviet stereotypes, but they are trying to do it with Ukrainians, pro-Ukrainian lyrics. Yes. And also use of symbols and symbolic language and metaphors is also very interesting one. So if you remember in the very beginning, I told you about using Tolkien language and Lord of the Rings symbols. It was also very widely used in Ukraine. For example, you can see this charcoal. It was also very, very popular in Ukraine. You can just, you can imagine what is here, but the name of this this thing is Mordor on fire. Mordor on fire. So this is also one of the symbols of the Tolkien. But and these symbols were also used even by President Poroshenko in 2015. He accused. He said that Novorossiya is a failed state, failed project, and he named Novorossiya as a Mordor as well. And also this was used by Martin Brest. He is a former soldier, now he is an anchor on the Army FM. And his novel ATO, Anti-Terrorist Operation in Middle Earth, has went very viral, like very viral on Facebook. Now he's very popular Facebook blogger and an anchorman. And I also had a conversation with one of the political characterists, Pekelny Bulba. And he said that he's trying to paint paint enemies or separatists like very, you know, cruel, like they are orcs. At the same time, he tries to illustrate Ukrainian forces like dwarves, like elves, and so on. I can speak for example, if you can speak for hours, I can speak for days about Ukrainian humor. But I would like now to go more to the global conclusions, which I actually promised to Zaneta. Yes, so considering all this, humor is a universal tool for strategic communication, since it can be disseminated quickly and with minimal effort. On one hand, humor must be supported by real facts and news. On the other hand, it creates an altered reality. Humor often requires the use of stereotypes and social political myths. It is used to diminish opponents' capacities and to emphasize our own strengths. Humor is an adaptive reaction during the so-called borderland state and can be used as a tool for overcoming fear and panic. There should be a proportional, which also very important, proportional use of humor. Otherwise, it can be perceived with mocking or light-minded connotation. And some future perspectives also very important. So this is just only one part of analyzing humor. But I have like my own question: how does humor correlate with facts? With so what is what we call objective reality, or even how does it correlate with ethics? Is humor able to influence an outgroup, or is it mainly a concentrated defense and counterattack tool for ruining alien messages? Can humor contribute to gain peace and to conflict resolution? Is there an universal formula for using humor in strategic communication? Can biochemistry of humor be formalized? If yes, then how will it impact capabilities and efficiency of humor, which is supposed to be spontaneous and viral? You see lots of questions, but nevertheless, there is no doubt that the humor is a very serious tool. Now I would like to thank you. I would like to thank all the members of the team. I would like to thank Janetta, Thomas. Of course, I would like to thank NATO Stratcom Center of Excellence. And I would like to thank you, audience, for your attention, and of course, those who are watching us online. Thank you very much.
So thank you very much. And even if we are behind of schedule, now we came to conclusions part, and then we'll have discussion part. So now I would like to ask again Janeta Ozolina to present us the conclusions of the study.
Thank you very much, and thank you, Maxim. You already did part of my job. So we had agreement with Thomas, so if we will be behind the schedule, I will be very short with my conclusion, so I will try really to keep my promise. So first of all, conclusions, recommendations part in our study they are done in a form as executive summary. So usually in NATO Stratcom publications, they have executive summary in the beginning of the study. So we decided to do it in a different way. So conclusions are and recommendations are made in a form of executive summary. So these are not just only lines, but they are explaining how we arrived at certain conclusions and what recommendations derive from those conclusions. So therefore, first part of conclusions, they are called general conclusions and recommendations, which we learned during our study. And it's again a combined endeavor of all scholars. Then there are conclusions and recommendations which are deriving from each of five pillars. It's in the case if somebody wants to work only with a perception of humor or with a target audience. So no need to read everything, probably just go and read this particular part. So then we also have a section which is devoted to research methods. And this was also questions asked during our study. So why we are using one or another method and why we are ignoring another one. So we collected those different views and we included into this research. Just in the case if somebody wants to continue, then there are some highlights where probably scholars should go and pay attention to. And then we in the end made a toolkit. But it's not very well visible, but I don't suffer so much of this poor visibility because all of you have your publications on hand, so you can go and look. But I will quickly explain what this toolkit means and how we arrived at it. So at one point when our study was somewhere in its middle stage, some of civil servants from ministries were asking, okay, you will have a lengthy study, but what we civil servants can do with the study. So, and then we decided that probably to save some time for civil servants who don't have time to read 157 pages, at least to produce one page which could they find relevant for their work if they will come across issue of humor. So first of all, again, we divided this toolkit in five sections according to our five pillars of humor. And somebody want to do something, again, with the human practical terms, these are indications what scholars or policymakers should focus on. So what is the shared past of particular audience, for instance? What defines the boundaries of the group, if we go further? What forms supporting the sense of belongingness we, us, or them, what also Sigita mentioned, are. So I'm not going one by one, but I will explain you, I just explained you that don't be surprised that this toolkit appears in the end. It's just a summary again of the main findings, which can be applicable in a case if somebody wants to study research. And ending up, one of, I think, golden rules which we arrived at, we suffered writing the study in English. When somebody is dealing with humor, the language is the most important component. It's almost impossible to translate the whole richness of each individual home humor you are facing at. And this morning, again, thinking about this presentation, I was going through also different examples which I was collecting. And there are so many interesting cases, but they cannot be used just because of specificity of language. So therefore, if somebody wants to work with humor, it's very important to work with people who really has not only very good knowledge, but who are carriers of this particular language, and it will bring you closer to shared knowledge, to target audience, to perception, to functions, and also to communication. So thank you very much. Now we can switch to the most interesting part.
Yeah. I would like to ask you not to leave the stage, and now I'd like to invite the researchers to sit here in front. And I hope we will be tortured by your questions very harshly, but we are prepared.
What a military terminology, torture.
Yeah. Yes, sorry. Yes, I cannot escape that. So 2 days before, we were listening what Russian TV channels were saying about our study. They were focusing on some few lines only. But let's say we were ready to hear that, yes, it was so important to them. So we really looked behind the curtain, and we are happy now to answer the questions which you have for us. Thank you very much. Please. So now, the questions. Sorry, I would like to give a question to our technical person. So should we use now the microphone for the internet users that they can hear the questions?
There's no need for that.
No need. Okay, so just raise your hand and give your question to us. No questions. Really? Yes, there is one.
Yes, Alex Yagoda is Walton from Black Sea Alliance. Well, I think the study has presented very well the sort of the ways how humor can be used for basically a political purpose, and also how it is used by the Russian channels, by the nitros there for a political purpose. I think the G7 was lost on most of the audience, so I may maybe mention that "ge" in Russian means shit. So he was sort of saying that instead of G7, we have now G7. G8, we have now G7, which is shit. Anyway, but I think that the whole, if we make a sort of step aside, the whole study presents a more, I would say, global issue, and that is of countering countering information aggression, which can be also done by means of humor. Our first reaction to this information aggression was that we should react with presenting truthful facts to the alternative facts. But now we see that there's a lot more than just facts. How can we counter that kind of information attack, which is presented in the form of humorous fellows and so on? Thank you.
Thank you. So very interesting question. Thank you very much. I think we should start from Jeanette.
Do I have to push the button now? Okay. First of all, we didn't look at humor as information aggression, to make it clear. We look at humor as a very rich phenomenon, which is used by different countries, and here in the case studies we have two countries presented, but behind the study, of course, we have done a lot of research on American late night shows and so on. So therefore, it's definitely not part of information aggression, which would be an integral part of the study. But this question which you, Alex, asked is very valid. But at the moment, I don't have answer for that. Because humor, in essence, it's always combination of facts and misleading some kind of a myth about this phenomenon. And this is typical for humor. We cannot require that somebody who is performing humorous shows suddenly is 100% repeating pure facts from Wikipedia, statistical data, or whatever. It always will be a mixture. It's much more important to understand how it's functioning. It's much more important to understand how this phenomenon is built, how society is perceiving it. And actually, as I mentioned at the very beginning, the study is very much about emotions. And humor teaches us how emotions work. So therefore, I don't have a clear answer what we should do, because there will not be a golden answer. I think there is not such a person in the world who would be able to answer you this question. It's more about trying to think about it, and probably in one or another way to analyze those humor show, not always from only humor's perspective, but probably also considering that it contains a certain component of propaganda.
Anyone want to add something? No? Maxime?
Just a few words. If you remember, that was actually one of the questions in the end, so that's why I don't have a definite answer. But I think that I came to the conclusion that humor is a very good tool for, let's say, soft propaganda. What I'm trying to say that, well, the humor is not about lies. Of course, humor is about creating alternative reality, alternative facts. But it doesn't mean it's dishonesty. I tried also to analyze one of the Russian comedy TV shows, which is called Mount Show. And I try to analyze the strategies which is being used. So first they start with the real fact. After that they skip to some joke, and after that they skip to some stereotypes, and after that the whole message, the whole news is being nothing. So after that, after it is being satirized, it doesn't mean if it's true or not. So after it has been satirized, that's the whole absolutely another reality. I guess I answered some of your question.
Yeah, and if I may add, it was what I saw in late night shows. It was the same actually. That at first they talk about Hillary, about elections, and they finish with the news about Playboy. So you see, they blur the lines between the important fact, then they make like a fun, and then they return about to the, for example, drinking problems in Russia or something. So the news, which would be important, actually, is a blur between not important news. so to make people to pay attention to something else, actually.
Yeah, and if I may add from my side, not being researcher, but being user and consumer of what the research team made, so and watching at the reaction of the other side for a few days now, it seems that the best solution is to analyze it. So when we started, we just looked at humor, how it works, how it is constructed, why it is like that, and the reaction was fierce. Why? Because it's only humor. Somehow, it's very vulnerable to some of the nations, where not for us. So therefore, probably the analysis of, let's say, what has been done, it is also the act of, let's say, becoming resilient or understand why it is so. Yes, maybe other questions?
Just one.
Yes,
please. Just wanted to add one quote by Martin Brest, which I have mentioned, and he said a very good thing when I had a conversation with him, Martin Brest, the blogger and the anchorman of Army FM. He was also a soldier, and he said a very good phrase, which I memorized. He said that in 2014, 2016, we have mocked this war. He said, "Мы заржали эту войну." It means that they, by using humor, they have absolutely, the most of the messages of Russian propaganda have been absolutely ruined. Yeah.
Yes, so we have one question here.
My name is Yuris Olmanis from Latvia. Maxim gave an excellent presentation and many good examples of counter-propaganda using humor. Did you take a look at any counter-propaganda activities using humor from Latvia at all? Do you have any examples?
No.
Several years ago, I was doing a presentation on the identity of the Baltic states, and I decided to choose humor as one of characteristics for the Baltic identity of each Baltic state. And I discovered that at that time, if you Google Latvian jokes, you could find only three. I know all three about Estonians. Sorry. Now the situation, of course, is slightly better in terms of quantity of jokes, but not in terms of laugh or gaiety, because these are jokes which are collected by historians from Gulag camps. Which are mostly about potatoes. It's more like from folklore type of a basket. So unfortunately, we are not laughing. All our late night shows or humor shows last no longer than a couple of months, and then they are dinosaurs. So unfortunately, probably this study could be of big relevance also to Latvian audience and Latvian showmakers to think again and again why we are not laughing, because looking at functions of humor, stress relief, image building, and I could continue more and more, there is a lot of positive potential of humor which could be used also for our nation, which constantly is complaining. Probably it's time to laugh.
Yeah, that was one of the things I wanted to mention also, that as I am quite, I use quite a lot social media, and the problem is that many of the jokes are not supporting, they are not supportive, they are supportive for opposite narratives, and that's a problem, and I think that we should pay attention to that kind of jokes and how this influences the opinion of our society.
I would just say that, I haven't researched Latvian experience, but I have to say, based on my knowledge findings, that humor is probably one of the most complicated and creative tools of counter-propaganda, so if you would be, and probably one of the most, not the simplest, but one of the most effective. So if we take the most simple strategies, it's like ignoring or reflecting some of the messages, I think that humor is like a bomb on this, so it's level up.
So it needs much creativity. It doesn't mean that Latvians are not creative and great people, but it needs creativity, and of course it needs unfortunately the conflict situation like in Ukraine. So such kind of borderline state which I mentioned, they are causing this kind of creativity, which is also very important. So I don't think that it's a bad thing that Latvians don't have such experience.
Okay, thank you. Maybe some more questions. Yes, please.
Hello, my name is Julia. As you mentioned here, that your research has created a loud reaction in Russian media. And what I have seen up to now is a lot about exactly this TVN case. And it has created not only some comments, but also a lot of new humor based on that about the NATO agents in KVN and so on. Can we count this case like defensive humor that now they are defending from your research or
not? Yeah, if you allow me, I will jump as because I was following also those news, very interesting, and so not to jump on, let's say, the side of the science, but the side of practical use. Our study was, let's say, attempted to be derailed with humor, so mocked, so very bad quality. Like, oh, that is in Latvia, oh yes, Latvia, you know, quality is low. So that shows the importance of that study. And what was funny, they took KVN case study where there were like bolded text, and they watched only that. Probably they need to read more, and they will be more happy with this. Probably they will not find anything threatened, because we just look at the humor, how it looks like. And but there they, let's say, try to mix the picture, which is, of course, shows the importance. And I think this study has to be translated into Russian. That is my personal opinion, because that shows the importance. But let's say I would now like to give floor to the scientific people. Maybe they can have more solid approach than I have.
Personally, myself, I didn't do this KVN case study, so therefore I cannot dwell into details of that one. But I think that from my point of view, the most interesting is not the case only of reaction to KVN, but in reaction in general. But probably this is the role of humor, that humor makes people laugh. So if makes people laugh, okay, so why not to laugh? But probably this could be another circle of research to find out what was the main reason why one or another reaction. And indeed, probably it's worse to translate it in Russian and to distribute it much wider than probably the knowledge about our study would reach more people, and also in-depth of reading of the study could contribute to understanding of humor more globally rather than only in one part of the world.
Yeah, we have just discussed this KVN case with our colleagues from ICDS from Estonia. They had just chosen one specific topic, KVN, which is not the whole research. It's also one of the means of manipulation. Take one specific characteristic and saying that this is the real essence of research. But I would like to say regarding Ukraine, we don't have KVN like for several years, fortunately. I think it started like since 2014. We have our own league. Maybe it's not so popular, it's not called KVN, but still we don't have teams which are participating in Russian KVN. It's also, I think, a good thing. And what I also found important, if we speak about Ukraine, during the last 2 years we have, so the number of comedy shows in Ukraine have increased very significantly. And this is also probably one of the functions of humor, for being a tool for, how you said it, like, recreation, yes. Like,
From my part, I wanted to say that there was another way of manipulation as well. They asked the opinion of Maxim Galkin, one of the heroes in my late night show's case study. And actually, there was no word in my case study that Maxim Galkin was mocking Hillary or whatever, but his reaction was that, come on, I have never done this, why did they write this? But I didn't, so they just didn't read this research, actually. Like Thomas said, they had just some titles and tried to make fun, like they think funny news about this. And also there is a question, if our study is so silly, why they pay so much attention on it? And if the Ministry of Foreign Affairs is so keen in it, then why is it, if it's so silly, why they are so keen in it?
I think they saw one line when Ministry of Foreign Affairs was mentioned in connection with Galasashi Kirin and KVN also, so probably that was the case. But do you have a last question, because we are right at the time to the end our presentation? No last question. So, with this nice note, let's say, I would like to thank once again for the research team who did really marvelous job. They really invented and found very interesting topics about humor, how humor can be used for strategic communication or for communication or for defense or for whatever. It's a very interesting topic. Then I would like to thank for the University of Latvia who accepted us in this nice premises, nice auditorium. And also I would like to thank to every one of you who are here, who listened to us, who were patient. And thank you for the Facebook viewers. We had then 1,500 viewers, as I know, maybe it's even more now. So we are popular, and thank you very much for your attention. Now, it's not the end. I would like to invite you to the room downstairs, just next to the auditorium, where we will hear see the presentation of the exhibition of cartoons, Humor Militaris, in the backdrop of information warfare, and which will be presented by Colonel Vytautas Reklaitis, Lithuanian, who is the Chief of Staff of NATO Stratcom Center of Excellence. Thank you very much. Please, we go downstairs.